Hello everybody and welcome to another Manga Thoughts and Opinions video. This is being recorded at 1922 on the 19th of November. Just in case, just like one of the previous videos, that this actually doesn't get uploaded and published until a following day. I don't have a lot of time to actually make this video, so I apologize if it feels a little bit more rushed than normal. Not that the previous ones were rushed by any means, but if I have to abruptly stop at any point, I'll just cut the video and then splice it together with another one if I have to, you know, two-parter sort of deal. Whatever, that's only if that happens. Regardless, we're talking about ReZero, Starting Life in Another World, Chapter 2, A Week at the Mansion, Volume 4, which I loaded up, yes, I loaded it up by walking over to my bookshelf and pulling it off the bookshelf earlier today while I was, what was I doing? I think I had gotten a new set of videos to upload and I just wasn't doing anything, so I sat down and decided to read the next book. And for whatever reason, despite the fact that this is one of the thicker books in Chapter 2, I managed to finish it quicker than I finished the other chapters, or excuse me, the other volumes, or at least it felt like I had. But regardless, this particular volume has 7 total chapters within it, with, I believe, is it 6 or I think it's 5 story chapters and then 2 bonus special stories. But okay, so very excited, of course, to continue talking about ReZero in the manga because I have been thoroughly enjoying it. And this was the big turnaround for the character Rem and Ram as well. So we get a lot about them. We do get a little bit about some other characters too, although most of this particular book takes place in the forest. See, the last book obviously ended, the final chapter had ended where Subaru had convinced Rem and Ram that there's an issue in the village, and Rem went off with Subaru to save these kids, and as they march off into the forest, that's where the book ends. Now we get to spend basically this entire book in the forest, which is kind of mind-boggling that you go through 5 chapters, though to be fair, some of the chapters are broken up with like backstory and flashbacks. It's surprising to go through 5 freaking chapters of the basically the same area and not even realize that it has been that long you've been spending there. If the sanctuary arc gets multiple chapters like that, or multiple books, but it doesn't feel like it, I will be so happy. I will be so happy. You have no idea. Anyways, let's start off with Chapter 1, Episode 16, titled Demon Beasts. Let me get my book out here so that I make sure that I've got some stuff. This is probably going to end up being the shortest of my manga videos for ReZero so far. Okay, so Subaru and Rem have charged off into the forest to look for the village kids who have recently gone missing, and something seems to be awry. We know that this little puppy dog thing is the shaman, in quotations, that has been cursing our Subaru. Now, they do locate the village kids. They are all safe, though, obviously, I think that they are cursed, but the curse is later lifted. However, there is one kid that is still missing, and Subaru decides he's going to go and hunt this kid down all on his own. Rem has to stay and take care of these kids, at least for a brief moment of time, so that they are sort of, I don't know, resuscitated, because they're obviously suffering in some way. And it's very dangerous, very stupid, in fact, for Subaru to go off into the forest alone like this, but he is just so determined, and he decides to make a promise, a pinky promise, with Rem, because, of course, Rem is very suspicious of him, and he decides that, you know, the best way for us to earn trust is if we promise to talk to each other when all of this is over, because Rem obviously has a lot of questions for him, and he has a lot of questions for her. So, if we get done with this, when this is all over, we'll talk and we'll ask each other all kinds of questions and have just a whole bunch of fun. Now, that doesn't actually end up happening at all. Instead, we get a whole different outcome to the story, as the cover of the book might imply. But we do further earn trust with Rem, or at least Subaru does, because he acknowledges that he knows about the witch's scent, which is something that she didn't know that he knew, and she even says in response, Subaru, just how much do you know? You know, obviously, again, he can't really explain why he knows all of this. He just has to play along with the fact that he does know it and give her... And this adds trust because, obviously, now she knows that he knows that she's suspicious of him. So, therefore, he hasn't tried to do anything nasty, I guess, at all, even though he already knew that, which might put her muscles at ease. And thankfully, in this particular volume, we do learn exactly why Rem is so aggressive towards Subaru, or has been in the past, and is so suspicious. So the little puppy dog has Maw Beast, or Demon Beast, reinforcements. This is where we get to see the true nasty beast. It's not just a little dog that we're hunting after. There are these large creatures, which we do learn the name of them in the next chapter. They're called, I'm probably going to get this pronunciation wrong, they're called Urugarum. I don't know what the fuck, they are demon dogs, basically. And I gotta say, I like their design in the anime as well, but here in the book especially, I love the way that they're designed. I love how they have a horn coming out of their snout, how they've got two giant fangs pointing up, almost like an orc. Really sharp teeth, just... I love the way that these things are designed. They look really scary, and like they could do a lot of damage if they started ripping and tearing. But what's nice is that when Subaru does locate this lost kid who is still alive and breathing, he has to go one-on-one with one of these new demon dogs. And I love the way that he actually does it. He takes... Now, I can't actually remember what he used. I don't know if it was his jacket or some piece of clothing that he wraps around his arm. And he then uses that arm to brace when the dog lunges and latches onto his arm with its mouth. And he then basically fucking... I don't know what the hell you call that. What's that move? That wrestling move? Whatever. He throws it up over his head and it lands on a really sharp branch. And it's disgusting because this artist knows how to do guro, basically. So you got these intestines coming out of the dog from where the spike of the branch has broken through, which is of course awesome to see. But regardless, I thought it was really badass for Subaru, somebody that doesn't really have any combat talent, to manage to think that up on the fly and use it. I mean, hell, I would have never thought about protecting my arm with clothing like that from something, but it makes total sense. So, Rem then, of course, arrives, and we get to see Rem be totally badass in this entire volume. She is in combat. We get to see just how powerful she is when she's not one-shotting Subaru, or two-shotting Subaru, for that matter. So we get to see her kick total ass, and while they are escaping the area with the child, Rem, who stayed behind to fight, catches up with Subaru, and all covered in blood, she pushes Subaru away, and a massive explosion occurs. Now, I think what you're supposed to assume at first is that Rem was pushing him to safety because she was about to be overwhelmed with the demon dogs. But what actually occurs is we see Rem's true form, and this is where it's fully revealed what Rem really is, and of course what Ram really is. She transforms into a demon. Now, her transformation isn't body morphing or anything. She basically just grows a horn on her forehead, a singular horn, and she goes berserk mode. Now, we do learn later how this works, and I'll kind of talk about it now because I didn't write it down in my notes. This is something you do learn in a later chapter of this particular book. But the way that demons work when they go into their demon mode, or they call upon the Oni, it's explained that they draw power from the mana from around them in the surrounding areas, which we've already learned about that in the past, that spirit users get their magic ability, very powerful, but they have to draw mana from their surrounding area, and thus if that area gets sucked dry, they no longer have power. Well, the same thing goes for demons. They get their power when in demon mode by sucking the mana out from around them. Unfortunately, if that area depletes of mana, they actually basically start killing themselves. They start doing damage to themselves. But the trade-off is that they have a huge berserk mode and they can kick some serious ass. And now I already saw her kicking ass, so I don't know why she needed to go no demon mode, but she needed to go demon mode. I guess because she was running out of energy, like actual exhaustion was starting to catch up with her, whatever. That's where the chapter ends. Good cliffhanger, showing us a transformation in our true form of what Rem is. Now everything makes sense. All of those references to demons, when Rem would ask something like, you know, do you like demons? the story in the children's book that Ram said not to tell to Rem, etc., etc. It all makes sense now. There was analogies being made and comparisons and metaphors being made about demons, and now we know that the maid sisters are demon sisters, which is totally badass. I see, at least in media, not in a biblical format, demons are so fucking badass. Every time there's a demon anything, it's always kick ass. You know, like, every single time. And now we have two demon sisters that kick ass, that wear maid outfits. What more could you ask for? I mean, whatever. So chapter 2, episode 17, titled The Way of the Demonic, part 1. So this is actually the first time where we have had a multi-part chapter in one of these volumes. So after... hold on, let me see here. Where am I at? My notes here. Okay, yeah, so while Rem is in her demon mode and fighting, she actually gets overwhelmed, and Subaru comes charging in and pushes her out of the way to safety. Unfortunately, Subaru gets jumped by a whole bunch of demon dogs in the process, which results in him getting chewed to pieces. Now, I was actually looking forward to this, because I remember this from the anime, and I was looking forward to seeing how this artist portrayed him getting ripped to shreds. He doesn't die, but he definitely gets beat up and is about to die. It's actually not as brutal as I thought it would be, but you still do get to see multiple demon dogs munching on him, and I don't think anybody would want that. I mean, it's bad enough when a little fucking shih tzu dog nibbles at your kneecap. Actually, hell, it can't even reach that. It nibbles at your shin, let alone multiple massive dogs that are basically as big as you, chomping on every which limb and stomach, and it's like, ooh. Especially with all those teeth and how sharp those teeth are. Yeah, I don't need that in my life, thanks. He nearly dies, but he wakes up back in the village. The children are safe. Everything seems to be perfectly fine, and he's been healed back to health by Emilia once again, who is passed out from exhaustion from healing him, so he doesn't wake her. We also get to see Ram, we get to see Puck, and we even get to see Beatrice. Now, we learn a lot of stuff in this particular chapter. First of all, we learn that Subaru is going to die in about a day and a half, and that's because every which one of those dogs that nibbled on him ended up placing an individual curse on him. And the problem that Beatrice and or Puck has with getting those curses lifted like we could before easily with the one is that how Beatrice explains it is that, at least in the book here, you have to think of a curse rite as being a knot. So you have to untie the knot, and you can untie knots if you're skilled. I am not, so I cannot do that. Now imagine multiple curse rites all mixed together. It's like when you have three or four different types of wire and they somehow get tangled with each other and you just don't know how to get those fuckers untangled. That's basically what's happening. There's too many curses to lift off of him. So, but there is one thing that they can do. If the curse givers, so the demon dogs, are actually killed off, then his curse will be lifted. Which begs to ask the question, where is Rem? Well, it turns out that Rem, feeling quite guilty for basically putting Subaru in that situation, or feeling like she had put Subaru in that situation, has charged off into the forest and has been fighting nonstop while Subaru was healing the whole time. Which already shows that there has been development with Rem and how she sees Subaru. She now trusts him enough that she's able to feel something for him, feel guilt, when he puts himself in harm's way to protect her. And after seeing how he treated these village kids and how he looked with such determination to march off alone into a forest of demons, you know, that's given her more reason to feel this way about him. Ram overhears this from Beatrice, and this now begins our second trip into the forest, where Beatrice stays behind. It would have been badass if Beatrice marched off into the forest too. I would have loved to see that. Where Ram and Subaru team up to head off into the forest to save Rem specifically. We're not really worried too much about his own curses right now, but we do learn that Ram is hornless. So now that we know Rem has a horn and she's a demon, we have learned that Ram does not have her horn. She lost it. Thankfully, we do actually get to see how that occurs in a later chapter in this book, but because she doesn't have her horn, she can't go demon mode. Thus, she's also not as powerful in combat as Rem is. Rem is just OP, basically, compared to her. Instead, she has the use of very basic magic. Now, I would argue that she's still very powerful with her magic uses. And she also has access to something called clairvoyance, which allows her to see through things. I don't know, whatever. I'm not going to sit here and act like I know what the fuck clairvoyance means. But it basically allows her to sense certain things that are on the same wavelength. So she's able to see Rem if they're on the same wavelength, but they can't see each other, which is supposed to imply that Rem is currently in demon mode. So they're not thinking with the same brain waves. I don't know. I don't understand no clairvoyance bullshit. This is also where we learn that these things are called Urugarums, the demon dog things. I don't know. First they were demon beasts, then they were first they were mob beasts, then they became demon beasts, and now they're Urugarums. Fucking whatever, who cares? Anywho, that's the end of that chapter. Now we're on to chapter 3, episode 18, The Way of the Demonics, part 2. We're in the forest, Rem's in the forest too, but Ram and Subaru are in the forest. We learn about demons. We learn that demons are usually born with two horns, as you would expect. That's what I would expect too. However, when twins are born, each twin basically adopts one horn. So that's why Rem has only a singular horn. And usually, apparently, twins are killed as being abominations to demonkind for whatever reason. Why you would want to kill these little cute shits, I don't know, that's just awful. But that obviously didn't happen, though we're never given a reason why they weren't killed. I don't know if that reason was ever given in the anime. We haven't gotten that far in the anime yet. But this is also where you technically learn about how they use their power and how they draw off of mana and stuff to go into their berserk mode. But because they're having issue finding Rem, Subaru uses his big brain mode, and he decides to attempt, and he now uses this as a strategy. Obviously, we saw him try to tell Amelia about his return by death before, and his heart basically wanted to stop working as somebody latched onto it from within. Well, he is now using that as a strategy, because when he does this, his whole body emits that scent of the witch, which is going to draw the demon beasts in. And when the demon beasts come, guess who's going to be following? Rem. So he's doing a total big brain mode. And of course, he's got some balls to be able to do that, to be able to put himself in such pain and agony to put up with all that. Let me see. Okay, where are we at here? Right, okay, so what happens next is essentially a pretty big fight where there is a lot of demon dogs that have arrived. Rem has arrived, and she's totally out of it. She is within her demon mode, full and through. She's pissed at Subaru for holding... She doesn't know it's Subaru, but she's pissed that this person is holding on to her sister, who is... If I remember correctly, I believe her sister basically gets knocked out because she uses too much of her power in combat, and she basically gets exhausted really, really fast. So Subaru is carrying her around the whole time. Now, the only way to knock Rem out of her killing spree is to blow her horn, basically. Hit her horn. Now, I remember being very confused about this in the anime, because in the anime, I thought that Subaru cuts her horn off, because I thought that they show it, like, spinning away, right? That's what I thought that he does. But apparently, no, she doesn't actually lose her horn at all, if I'm not mistaken. It's just a big old blow to her horn that knocks her out of it. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong on that, but they definitely don't show her horn getting cut off in this particular book. Either way, Subaru needs to use a sword that he got from... because he actually got a whole bunch of things from people in the village for helping and to charge off and try to find Rem. And one of the things he got was a sword. And he tries to swing, and he misses at first, but he comes back down and manages to hit her in the horn. But we don't actually know if it was a full success, as this is where the chapter ends and starts us on the very next chapter, which is chapter 4, episode 19, simply titled Rem. This is the really important backstory that we get on Rem and Ram that will further expand upon these two characters quite extensively, actually. But we learn that Rem and Ram were born in a small little village, and that Ram was actually excellent. She was like the prodigy child, and everyone loved her. She was very powerful. She was a very good magics user, and Rem was kind of the underdog. She wasn't able to do very well with magic. She didn't have very many skills. She couldn't really do many things, which is kind of the polar opposite of how we have been introduced to these characters in their adult life. I say adult, they're still teens, aren't they? I don't actually know how old these characters are, but compared to their children age, obviously, we've seen that it's the exact opposite with how we know these two characters. Rem, unfortunately, was basically frowned upon for not being as good as her sister, and for being too weak, and she's basically always belittled for endangering Ram, who is always sticking up for her sister and always out there to help her sister and make her sister feel love. Ram is not like a shitty sister that gloats because of all this love and attention she gets. She totally loves her sister. She loves her little Rem. But Rem starts to grow resentment, but not in the way you would expect. You see, I would expect, and normally you would expect, that Rem would grow resentment for her sister, who is getting all of this attention, and she gets to sit there and suffer all day long because of it. But no, she actually grows resentment for herself, because she's endangering her sister. She loves her sister, and you know, all this belittlement that she gets makes her believe that she really is useless, that she really is weak, rather than her growing a hatred for her sister, which I really like that aspect of Rem. But we get a pretty shocking scene that I remember loving this in the anime too, but we get a pretty shocking scene where Rem is having nightmares as a kid, and Ram is there to comfort her, and just very, very beautiful scene. But unfortunately, when Rem falls asleep and wakes up again, and now I don't know how the fuck this little shit managed to sleep through that, but trust me, she was crying, and when you cry and then fall asleep, you're sleeping like a brick until you wake up. But she wakes up, Ram's not in bed, and she hears noise outside, so she goes to the door and opens it up, and what she finds is pretty shocking. Now, it goes by really quick in the manga, so you might not notice it unless you look really closely, but it is the village is on fire, there is piles of burning bodies, and there are these people in these like cloaks that look very cultish with these daggers, and they're killing people, and they go to strike Rem down when Ram comes out of nowhere in full combat ability, just blasting these people left and right. But unfortunately, when she focuses her attention on Rem to save her, she loses her horn in the process. And this is how we actually see her lose her horn, and this is how we now know that she lost her horn. Now, we do know before that Roswell is the one who saved these two characters, and that's why they serve him so with so much loyalty. Unfortunately, we don't actually get to see that, though, here. It just, I guess, happens at some point following this event. But pretty shocking scene, nonetheless. And this is why, because Ram had lost her horn, she now loses basically all of her ability to be good at everything she was good at. And Rem feeling not only all that resentment that she had built up about herself throughout her childhood, but she is now feels entirely responsible for what happened to Ram, which is why she is always so caring for her sister. She puts her in so high regard because she believes that she is perfect. And so she strives to be what her sister would be so that she can... It's definitely depressing the way that she treats it, but it's almost really heartwarming at the same time because she cares so much for her sister. Like, I love that aspect of Rem, that she didn't grow resentment against her sister. Instead, she loves her sister to death, but at the cost of herself, which makes Rem very much almost like Aki in that regard. I think I even said this recently when I said to Aki that I am Beatrice and you are my Rem, basically, because Rem constantly, when she cares about somebody, she puts them ahead of herself basically until death, no matter how much damage it or harsh it is on her, or how difficult things are to get through for her. It doesn't matter, as long as the other person is being cared for first. And that's Rem's character in a nutshell, which is why I think so many people love Rem, Well, I'll say that's why at least a good portion of people love Rem. I know a lot of people just like maids. I do. Do they like short hair? I do. They like blue hair? I do. But I think a lot of people just like her because she's cute rather than actually giving a shit about her character, which to me only enhances those cute looks, in my opinion, and makes her a character that I care about a lot more. Especially with what happens at the end of this volume, it only hurts me a little bit more, but regardless. So this is where we learn fully that the reason why Rem didn't trust Subaru so much was because he had the scent of the witch on him, which is the same scent she remembers from the attack on her village, and thus she wouldn't trust this guy at all. And this makes all sense. So when you have the references to how they didn't want Rem to get out of hand, Roswell didn't want Rem to get out of hand in regards to Subaru, or how, for example, Rem felt that she wanted to take out Subaru before it was too late because she didn't want to wait and then have Subaru end up, you know, enacting some attack on the mansion and hurting her sister or anyone else. That's why she was so aggressive about it. Sure, she probably went way overboard with it. All she needed to do was confront and not actually kill on sight. But I don't exactly blame her either for the traumatic experience she had as a child. I mean, not everyone wakes up to watch their village burning and then see their sister almost fatally wounded and lose all of her power because of you, and then to smell that same smell you remembered from back then on somebody that randomly shows up that you've never seen before, that no one knows, that he doesn't even know where he even comes from, you know. Of course, there you're going to be suspicious and you're going to want to protect everyone around you, especially when times in the country are at an all-time negative right now, whereas there's shit going on during the royal selection. So I definitely don't blame Rem at all. And we also don't get a lot of time with Rem being the bad guy, so to speak. We only get it for just a short period of time in this arc, and then she becomes good Rem, like we get in this volume. And from this point forward, I would argue that Rem is one of the best characters in ReZero, at least until where the Sanctuary arc, where she just doesn't exist. And I mean that truly. And it's not even just because I think she's adorable. It's because I think she is truly the best character in ReZero, purely for her devotion to her sister and people she cares about, how powerful she can be, but also how weak she can be, because she's not invincible either. And unfortunately, she gets treated like shit during the Sanctuary arc. So it's just another reason for me to hate Sanctuary. But whatever, we were getting way too far ahead of myself again. Okay, so let me see, is there anything else here? Right, when Subaru manages to successfully, we're done with the flashback and we're back to where Subaru had successfully knocked her on the horn, which knocks her out, so she's debilitated. Ram is back on her feet now, so Subaru says, take Rem, get out of here, because I'm going to stand one-on-one with that little puppy dog, the final boss, and have a big old showdown with him. Which, of course, Rem ends up waking back up, and this is the first time, according to how it is stated, this is the first time that Rem actually goes against what her sister's wishes are. Because obviously up to this point she has lived by her sister's life, essentially. What would my sister do? Well, now she is in tears, she's crying, you can tell she has grown feelings, not necessarily romantic feelings, but she has grown a lot of care for Subaru, who has been there for her way more than she knows up to this point. And is there for everyone else. Basically, a mirrored image of herself. And I love the way that she even explains that this guy, he doesn't have any ability in combat. He's not strong. He's weak. And he knows it, too. It's in his face. You can see it on his face. Yet he still marches off into danger, regardless, because he always cares for everyone else. That's exactly who Rem is, too. So I think that's probably why there's a lot of connection between the two characters. But regardless, Rem is bawling her eyes out. She wants to go back, while Ram says, there's no reason to go back. If we go back, we're basically soiling the whole reason why he's he's standing on his own anyways, but for the first time, Rem doesn't agree with her sister. Unfortunately, though, they don't get involved, so we don't get a cool three-way battle, but fortunately, though, they don't get involved, because obviously Rem is not in any fighting capacity right now. Ram is probably not fully juiced up either, and we do get a pretty badass standoff with Subaru and the demon puppy. By the way, one thing that I forgot to mention, I even forgot to mention it in my notes until I wrote it down later, that during the flashback where we actually get to see Rem and Ram at the mansion for the first time, they're actually quite young, by the way, when they're brought in. So, I mean, they were brought in as children, so they've been at the mansion for a very long time serving Roswell, but we do get to literally see Frederica in the flashback. I don't remember if that happens in the anime. I do know that there is one frame in the anime where you do see Frederica in the first season, because I remember not knowing that when I first watched, and then when people told me it in the comments section, I went back, and when I rewatched the show, I saw that scene and I was like blown away that there was another maid, because I didn't know there was more than the two maids. I had no idea. Well, you get to straight up see her right here in this chapter of Volume 4. And she looks exactly like how I remembered her from the anime, so the styles are still the same there. But regardless, that's the end of episode 19. So this brings us to chapter 5, titled simply, The Final Episode, Speaking About the Future. That's right, this is volume 4 of chapter 2, A Week in the Mansion, which is a 5-volume long arc, and it is also a 7-chapter long volume, but chapter 5 is the end of the story for this arc. That was quite surprising. That caught me off guard. Now, I did look. Of course, the next two chapters are just special stories, but the fifth volume is apparently just a collection of extras. It's not actually a continuation of the overall ReZero story. I had no idea, which explains why the front cover is Rem and Ram with cat ears. I guess because it's just a bonus volume, basically. Regardless, though, let's talk about the final chapter, which is a beautiful closing to the mansion arc. We have a one-on-one with the souped-up pup, which is the little puppy dog that has grown into a massive beast now. And the way that Subaru fights it, again, with somebody that has no combat capability, he has brains. He uses his dark magic ability, Shamak, or however you pronounce that, again, to great effect here, while also eating one of the boku fruits that he had gotten from one of the children in the village. And during this blackout, the smoke cloud, he manages to stab the beast in the neck, but unfortunately it doesn't knock it on its ass, and instead it pins Subaru down. But he, like a badass, grabs the sword, out of this beast's neck and stabs it in the eyeball, blinding half of its vision, which is totally awesome. And in that same moment, out of nowhere, a massive, almost meteor-esque like strike of magic comes down from the sky and just destroys this big beast. And then, almost comedically, you have Roswell in his little top hat come floating down from above. So he has returned. And we do learn that the reason why he had showed up when he did was because he was basically begged by Amelia to help Subaru. And in order to figure out where Subaru is, chances are he's going to use magic when he's backed into a corner. So just keep an eye on that. He used Shamak. Roswell noticed, came to help, and basically saved Subaru. But at the same time, I think Subaru was handling it pretty well on his own. But he wouldn't have been able to keep going, I think, is the idea here. With Roswell saving the day, he is also the one that helps to lift the curse off of him because I believe Subaru actually passes out again from exerting himself during this fight. And while he is healing up in the mansion, or on the way back to the mansion, or in the village, or whenever, Roswell was actually responsible for finishing off the rest of the demon dogs in the forest, and thus lifting the curse off of Subaru. They also repair the barrier around the village, so no more demon beasts are going to be getting in, which is fucking great. Thanks for that. And this is where we do get some other interesting tidbits. Before I talk about the Rem and Subaru interaction, we do get to see Ram with Roswell again, and this is where it is confirmed that yes, Ram was getting her she wasn't being sucked of mana, she's actually being regenerated with mana. Remember, I talked about, I believe in the previous volume, I didn't understand what was happening in that scene. Well, now we actually get to see that her mana is being replenished by Roswell. That's basically what's happening. Oh shoot, I didn't realize I had bent my page. That's depressing. Now we also get to learn a little bit more detail here about Roswell and Ram. So, first of all, Roswell is asking Ram, do we know who was behind the curse? You know, who was, because obviously the dog was there, but there had to have been somebody behind the curse. It wasn't just this beast. And Ram doesn't actually know. Now I'm curious to see if this happens in the anime too, because I don't remember this in the anime, but I'll have to keep a close eye on it when we get up to that episode. But Ram mentions that there was a child, an unknown child, that arrived randomly and disappeared as soon as the demon beasts were destroyed. And they show it in the book, and it's pretty clear who it is, though we don't know their name, but you do know their hairstyle, so it's very easy to tell which child it was. I believe it's the same child that was actually holding the puppy dog earlier on in the book. So that was interesting to see that detail. But Roswell also says that it's important that things go well for the royal selection in order for his plan to work. Now, we know that this guy is, I wouldn't say untrustworthy, but he's definitely mysterious at this point in the story because there's definitely more going on with him than meets the eye. And apparently his plan has something to do with slaying the dragon. Now, spoilers, but where we are in the anime, I haven't even seen a dragon yet, so much as slain one. So I'm pretty intrigued to see anything about no dragon and or slaying it and or Roswell being involved. So I think that's going to be pretty fun and interesting if we get that far in the story. The other part, the main important part of the final episode is, speaking about the future, is Subaru and Rem's interaction. Rem stays over his bed the whole time that he is healing and unconscious, and when he wakes up, she's holding his hand very adorably because he was having bad dreams, and she was there to comfort him and make sure he was safe. This is where Rem's devotion to Subaru begins from this moment, and as we will obviously learn later, where it's revealed that Rem finds Subaru to be her hero, and you can clearly see that by the way that she talks and interacts with him here. It is beautiful, the interaction these two characters have here. Like, I mean it. It is just gorgeous. This interaction is just one of the reasons why I say that Rem is the objectively better romantic interest, but as is the way that love works, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. So even though I think Rem is objectively better than Amelia from the point that she is vastly more caring and capable, that doesn't matter if you don't love somebody. If you love someone else, that's just how it is, and there's nothing you can do about that, and that's totally fine. So I'm not one of those salty people that hates ReZero because Rem isn't the main romantic interest, but I was pretty salty that she gets kind of tossed to the side in favor of Amelia, which I just was so angry because I felt Rem was just the better option for not only just the way that she treats Subaru, how she protects Subaru, how she talks to Subaru, how she thinks about him, what she's capable of, and then you've got Amelia over there sitting on her ass studying for some royal selection bullshit. Of course, I don't feel that way fully anymore now that I've seen season 2 and season 2 part 2 where we've seen what Amelia's been through and what she's even capable of. That wasn't the case as of season 1, so I had a much more harsh opinion against Amelia back then than I do now. But I still do firmly believe that, yeah, there's bias because I think Rem is the best character in the show. I love her, or excuse me, I say show, but in ReZero, I love her to death. I think she's amazing in all these different ways, not just personality, but how, what she's able to do. So yeah, of course I would want the main character to be with that fucking character. But no, she's got short blue hair, so of course she's going to get tossed to the side. Which sucks, honestly. But whatever, it's a story for another time. When we get closer to the actual romance-y stuff, we can talk more about this. But I just love the way that Subaru talks to Rem, because she's always talking down on herself and always beating herself up. She's literally like, Aki, you have no idea how much Rem is like Aki. that she's always beating herself up. It's always her fault. It's always something that's going wrong because of her. And Subaru just has to keep explaining that, no, you know, Ram was there, but guess who saved me? It was you that saved me, not Ram. You did. You know, all this kind of crap. It just to prove to Rem that she is a wonderful person and how capable she really is. And on top of that, we have the whole demon. Back to the story where when they were in the village together in a previous loop, where Subaru had said that he likes demons more than gods because demons will laugh with you when you talk about the future. Well, he says, you know what, Rem? Let's just laugh about the future. Let's sit together, think about what's ahead. It doesn't even have to be down the road. It can be so much as early as tomorrow, and let's just laugh about it. And that's, I thought that was a really great callback. It kind of brings everything together. And she has this really cute smile. And the cover of the book is actually a panel in the manga itself. And it's a one-to-one copy of each other, which is great. Because honestly, when I saw the cover of this book, I was thinking that this was from when they're in the capital later on in the story. You know, the one where Rem confesses to Subaru. That's what I thought this was an image of. And I'm like, we're not to that point already, are we? But no, if you look at the background, you can see a window frame in the background, which is the same window she's sitting in front of next to Subaru's bed when she gets all teary-eyed for how Subaru is treating her. And that's where the book ends. There isn't even a cliffhanger that gets you like all pumped up for the next one, except maybe the Roswell talking about his great plan and slaying the dragon. That's, I guess, the most of the cliffhanger you're going to get, than at the tease. But like, really, damn, seriously, that was a fantastic way to end the mansion arc. I loved this whole arc so much. It was so much fun to read through. And of course, we're not done with this chapter yet in the manga. There's still another volume to go of extras. And we, of course, still have the two bonus chapters I'm going to talk about here in a moment. But I loved every single bit of it, and I think it ends so well. It starts great, the middle is great, the mystery is great, the action is great, the brutality is great, the characters are great, the character development on Ram and Rem and Subaru as well is great. We get to see Beatrice more, we get to, as the story goes on, we get to learn more about her, though of course we still pretty much don't know really anything about her. Roswell's a really mysterious but intriguing character. The mansion is just a very memorable and iconic place, and we're going to see more of it later too. Rem has become a full-on party member now, basically, and I love the way that she just grows on Subaru and vice versa, and how caring she is, and how she's turned around to not be against Subaru but now with Subaru. I just love that transition a lot. And the way that it closes off is so satisfying too. Like, I could close the book and sure, I would want more ReZero, but I could be happy that this would be the end of ReZero. You know, I could honestly sit there and think, I'm satisfied with the way that ended. And yeah, I could. I'm not going to. Fuck that shit. We're reading more ReZero because this stuff's badass. But still, whatever. Overall, fantastic story for a week at the mansion. The mansion arc, the one that made me fall in love with the anime, and here it is in the manga that made me fall in love with ReZero again. And the manga is, it's just, it's not repetitive to read it. It wasn't boring to read something that I already knew the story for. It was really exciting. I was glued to the page, had my ass sitting on the floor all covered up in my blanket when it's nice and cold, and I got my notebook down there. I'm writing notes in after every chapter, and it's just so much fun, and I get through the book in a single sitting and not even realize that I'm done with the book as fast as I was. This one in particular. I mean, I opened it up and I'm done with it. I was so blown away that I finished the book as fast as I did, because I'm not a fast reader, mind you, and this is manga. You don't have to, of course, but there are panels of artwork that you're intended to immerse yourself in while you're reading, so there's a lot more going on than just read a couple words on a page and then flip to the next page. You know, you're getting involved in this story along with it, with the visuals that are being represented on screen, on paper rather. That's just how excited I was to read more, and that's just how into it I was. Now, I'm really excited to read Chapter 3, but we won't talk about my excitement there until we're done with Chapter 2, because we still have another volume. It's just so weird to me that we're done with this. The next volume is just extras. I'm very curious to see what those extras are going to be. Anyways, for the final two chapters, we have Chapter 6, which is titled Special Story, The Roswell Manor Girls Meet, Hot Bath Edition. Now, you might be thinking, wait a minute, we already had The Roswell Manor Girls Meet, Hot Bath Edition, right? Well, you would be correct. We did. In fact, we had it on, if I flip back a couple pages, I don't remember what book it was in, but it was at least a couple books ago. Yeah, right here. The Roswell Manor Girls Meet, Hot Bath Edition, was a short story in Chapter 6 of Volume 2. So this was two volumes ago. Notice, though, how these are not short stories. These are called special stories. These aren't novel pieces. These are actually manga. They're like little one-shot mangas. So we don't have the novel in this particular book. Instead, we get a manga version of the Hot Bath Edition, and it is exactly the same exact story that we got from the previous, from Volume 2, the novel version, but here it's just manga instead. So of course there's a lot less dialogue, a lot less detail in descriptives, but we get to see that stuff instead. So it goes by a little bit quicker, but we get to see, it was really funny to actually see Beatrice get picked up and launched into the bath. It was pretty much exactly how I had imagined it in my head when I was reading it the first time. There's nothing else to it. Since we already talked about it, if you want to know my full opinions on this particular short story, you would want to go and check that part of the Volume 2 video. But it is basically pure fan service. In fact, the author himself or herself even says that it's just for fan service to be able to see the naked bodies of the girls. Thank you for that. Also, Subaru even says that Rem is better than Ram because her boobs are bigger. Guys, look, enough with the big boob thing. I need a character that actually acknowledges smaller boobs are cuter than bigger boobs, because we just don't have that type of character. Where are those people? They're out there. I know they are. Flat justice. It's a thing. I believe in it. So moving on to the next one, we have Chapter 7, Special Story, The First Mayonnaise Insurrection, which is the final chapter of this book, and it is stupid as hell. Because I fucking hate mayonnaise with a burning passion. If there is anything food or condiment wise that I hate more than Hitler, it's mayonnaise. No joke. I cannot stand mayo. It is disgusting to me. The smell, the taste. If you put mayo in something as like an ingredient, even if it's just a little bit, I will notice it instantly and hate whatever it is I'm trying to eat that has that as an ingredient, because I pick it out immediately because it's just such a distinct, disgusting flavor. But people that love it, just like Subaru, will suffer withdrawals when they don't have it for long enough. So it's basically burning passion of hatred versus fiery passion of love, which is, it's a big old war between people that love and don't like mayo. But that's what this is about. Subaru is suffering a withdrawal because he doesn't have mayo in this world. This is exactly... Now, by the way, I don't really remember any filler in ReZero, except maybe the Sanctuary arc as its entirety. But to be in all seriousness, I don't really remember any filler episodes. There's usually something important happening in every episode, or the plot moves on in some way each time, at least to the best of my memory. This special story is exactly what I would consider a filler episode, but it's not, because it's bonus. It's just at the end, so it's not like it's filling anything in. It's just a little bonus that you can totally skip if you want to. But it chronologically does take place after the events of the story. So after the events of chapter or episode 20, which is the final episode, now that Subaru and Rem are on very good terms, Rem is in doggy mode. Basically, she is very, very obedient, and she wants to do her best for Subaru, and she wants to be praised by Subaru. So everything Subaru does, even when he's doing really crap, she praises him for it and says, it's your own way to do it, and you're doing great, basically, right? But essentially, this whole idea about mayo is brought up at breakfast, and Rem, and Subaru attempt to actually remake mayo from scratch, but he has to go based off of memory on what it might be made of. So he's got like eggs and, Later he gets vinegar involved and lemon juice, and they're trying to figure out, you know, okay, what exactly makes it. Ram ends up leaving, and it's just between Rem and Subaru, and ultimately Rem does successfully make mayonnaise. And surprisingly, and I say surprisingly, when they actually serve the mayo at the dinner table, everyone loves it. Roswald loves it, Amelia falls in love with it, Beatrice loves it, Puck loves it. I'm thinking, I know this is just supposed to be a funny comedy little bonus skit, basically, but not everyone loves mayo. Like, I'm telling you, even in my personal experience, for every 10 people that I meet, at least 7 of those 10 people despise mayonnaise. You cannot tell me that every one of all those different personalities are going to love mayo. Thank you very much. I do not buy that for one moment at all. You will love mayo, and then you'll have 7 people that hate mayo, and then you'll have 1 that loves mayo. I don't get it. I'm one of those people that's of the 7, personally, and I'm sure there's people listening right now, at least 10 years down the road, whenever somebody actually watches this, that loves mayo and is cursing me right now, but I don't like mayo. If I die and go to hell, it isn't going to be lava and fire, it's going to be pools and oceans of mayo. Speaking of pools of mayo, by the way, Subaru wants to take a dip in the pool, or I think it's a pool, actually it's a bath, but it's a huge-ass bath. And Rem filled it up with mayonnaise, because of course she does. And she then says, "Hey Subaru, did you enjoy that mayonnaise bath?" And then he chews her out. And that's basically where the little thing ends. But yeah, we get a really cutesy Rem who's always wanting head pats now, and she's always really adorable now, so she's a lot more lighthearted. Of course, she's not going to be in dog mode during the actual story. This is just supposed to be emphasizing and kind of satirizing the fact that she is a really cutesy, good girl now, as opposed to being the scary demon girl that we knew from earlier on in the arc. And overall, that brings the entirety of Volume 4 to an end. I already sang my praises for the previous one. We're going to read Volume 5 next, obviously, and finish off Chapter 2, A Week at the Mansion, officially, bring it to a close, and then talk about my excitement for Chapter 3. But as far as the story is concerned, I think this is going to be a 9 range rating manga entry on my analyst, because fuck you, that's why.